stand to our feet tonight. I want to welcome you all into the house of the living God as we give God the praise that He is worthy of. Come on, church. Let's lift our voice.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow, and I stand face to face with the enemy,
come.
I will know that I am not forsaken.
Yeah.
You surround me when the fire's at my feet. You're my defender, yeah. You fight for me, oh, I will remember your role on me. You are my life, my remedy, oh, against the power of the unknown. I will not stand alone. I can see you when the night is closing in,
oh,
and I will trust you when it seems that there's no home, oh, and I hold tight to the promise you have given,
hey,
this I know, and I am confident, you're my defender, yeah. You fight for me, oh, I will remember, you're all I need, you are my healer, my remedy, against the power of the unknown, I will not stand alone, you're my defender, yeah,
all the saints of God say, you're my defender, oh, yeah.
I'm saved by the blood, I'm saved by the blood of Jesus, saved by the blood, yeah. I'm saved by the blood of Jesus, saved by the blood. I'm saved by the blood of Jesus, saved by the blood. I'm saved, you're my defender.
Come,
you fight for me, no.
Say, you wash me in blood. Say, to move tonight. Come on.
And let the power of God fall down on us. Let your power fall down right now. Let the power of God fall down on us. Let your power fall down right now. Let the Spirit of God pour out on us. Let your Spirit pour out right now. Let the Spirit of God pour out on us. Let your Spirit pour out right now. For your glory and you only. What you say is what we'll do. Let your passion become action. Holy Spirit, come and move. Jesus, we're allowed to glorify. Oh, let your Spirit rise among us as we sing, say, Jesus, move. Oh, 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 Jesus, move. Oh, 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 oh. Let the love of God come alive in. Let your love come alive right now. Let the love of God come alive in. Let your love come alive right now. For your glory and you only. What you say is what we'll do. Let your passion become action. Holy Spirit, come and move. Jesus, we're allowed to glorify.
There is no one greater. You are lifted up, lifted up.
arms and come on. My Savior, oh, yeah. can search the whole world. Give him praise tonight. Give him praise right where you are. We rejoice in your name. We rejoice in your mercy, God. Wonderful, 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 wonderful. Glorious one of ages.
Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. That promise, that spirit of expectancy. God, we come into your presence knowing that in you is all good things. This is where we belong. I was talking to a brother before church and he said, hey, this is where I belong. This is where God has me. This is what I'm supposed to be doing right now. Amen. There's nothing like knowing, hey, I'm in the place where I need to be at the time I need to be there. And God is going to meet with me. Amen. We're going to go before the Lord and we're going to pray for our brother Chris Castillo de Oro. His wife Sonia is in need of healing. She needs God's grace upon her life. We're also going to pray for these services, these revival services, our co-workers, our family members that we've been praying for. I want you to pray for those people around you. Pray that God would have grace upon them, that God would move on their behalf. And we pray for everybody's vehicles and jobs this week. As we just come to church and we do what God has called us to do. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Brother Paul Gualtieri is going to come and open us in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your power and your grace, God. We pray that you would go before us in this time, God, that your hand would be upon our lives, God. Lord, those we've been praying for, those we've been praying over, God. Lord, move on our behalf, move in our lives, God. Lord,
hallelujah. Father, we're so grateful tonight to be in the house of God. We're so grateful to you, God, that you're a sovereign God. You know the beginning from the end, God. We bring our needs this evening to you, God. We believe and trust you, God, to meet every need. We lift up this service tonight. We come with open hearts, expectant hearts, believing you, God, to touch us, to change us, God, because we're a desperate and a needy people, God, and we thank you for all that you're going to do tonight in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Praise God.
Amen. You may be seated tonight if you're with us on live stream. We're so glad to have you this evening, the second revival service with our pastor Aaron Saavedra. One announcement, and that is we have revival tonight, tomorrow night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, all at 7 o'clock. You come, bring somebody to that. Maybe you've been praying for someone or witnessing to them. This is a great excuse to invite them to church. Like, hey, we got the super funny guy at our church. He's hilarious, and you're funny too. So I want you to come. I think you would enjoy it. Or just whatever you got to say. Bring them to church. God is going to move in their lives. And if you're part of the Atlanta team, going to Atlanta, I got a meeting with you by the drums after service. We got some information that we need to give you. So amen. That's enough announcements. We had a ministry go out of town last night to El Paso. Novo Destino went to El Paso, so Jose Urbina is going to come and give us a report of what happened last night.
Good evening, all. Novo Destino had the privilege of going to El Paso, and let me relate to you what we saw. We saw the spirit of hospitality, the spirit of generosity, the spirit of service, the spirit of contending. When we got into that prayer meeting, I don't know, it was on fire. And it really inspired us to excel. We did what we do. We played our songs. We testified. And, you know, God is so faithful. God is so faithful because there were 14 people that made decisions yesterday to give their lives to Jesus. 6 in the concert and 8 in the outreach. And let me just finish with this. 43 years ago, El Paso was a dream in my pastor's heart. And the spirit that we saw there yesterday was born in our pastor's heart. It was born here. And I saw the spirit, and I rejoice that you and I and what we do as a ministry God was able to bless it. And we thank you for your prayers. We thank you for your support and what we do as a group. Thank you very much.
Praise God. Just last week, I was MIA. My dad goes to Romania every year, and so he invited me to go with him. And I was supposed to go with him originally in 2020, but it was 2020, so I didn't go. Ended up hoarding toilet paper with everybody else, and so we rescheduled to 2022. So we go there. It's a men's rally that we're having, and there's men there from different countries, different nations, in Brașov, Romania, which is the mother church there in Romania. And I think I preached 7 times. My dad preached like 9 times. But what was awesome about it is these dudes are, I mean, it was very familiar. These guys are hardcore, right? Like, they were there for this. They were praying. They were responsive. And it's kind of hard to preach through an interpreter. At least for me it is. Pastor Mitch used to call him the interrupter. But these men were just there at the edge of their seats, just taking notes, just listening. Altars were packed. That's in Brașov, Romania, which is actually literally Transylvania, that Transylvania. And if you were to know like the history of that area, just the heartbreak and all the things that have happened over the centuries in that area, but you wouldn't know it just talking to the people in the church. They're filled with joy. They're filled with the presence of God and just all that God is doing there. Pastor Ovidio Rusu and Pastor Christy, they're doing outstanding jobs along with all the other pastors that are there. I had the opportunity to make that drive and then go to Bucharest, which is the capital of Romania, which is 2 million people. And what we found there was actually Orthodox Easter. And what we found there was just another church on fire for God. It was hilarious because it was Easter afternoon, and they're really big into Easter in Romania. Everybody comes. Our flight was full from London into Bucharest. Everybody's coming home for Easter, but it was Easter afternoon. They went and did all their fellowshipping, and then they would go into the park and rap and sing songs, invite people to church. And so every service, we'd have a lot of visitors in the services, and you could just feel the presence of God in every service halfway around the world. So the next morning, it's Monday morning, I'm leaving, and you're wondering, where does Phil Valine come in this story? Well, I'm glad you asked where Phil Valine comes in this story, because I get into the pastor's car, and I'm hearing Phil Valine singing. And he's like, yeah, I'm listening to the Tucson evening service right now. When I was there, everybody was asking for you guys. Yes, they were asking for Pastor Warner, Pastor Smith, and Pastor Garrett. They were asking for you guys, right? Because what you do and how you give and how you live is translating all over the world. These men literally learned English. These men and women literally learned English by listening to preaching tapes, and now they're learning it by listening to our services. So, and that's why I'm trying to speak correctly right now. That's everything that we do, God is using it. Here's another thing. They're 30 years removed from communism. Pastor Christie was telling me that money meant nothing to them because it doesn't really work in a communist system. Money, they didn't understand it. Now they're 30 years removed, and now they're sending churches into other nations. Now they're the ones giving the offerings. Now they're the ones being used through their money. And God is moving in their lives. Why? Because a church just like this, our mother church in Prescott, Arizona, our church here, churches all around the fellowship, blue-collar, white-collar men and women live their lives, give their offerings and give their tithes, and that's what happens. That's what happens. We give from a position of victory. Let's have the ushers come this evening. We give from a position of victory, knowing that everything that we do, God uses it to glorify himself and to advance his kingdom. Amen. We're going to bow our head in a word of prayer. And I want our brother Roman Moreno to go ahead and pray over the offering.
Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Every knee shall bow,
every knee shall bow.
I know they will.
Every tongue confess,
hey.
Jesus Christ is Lord forever.
And every knee shall bow,
every knee shall bow.
Oh,
every tongue confess,
Jesus Christ. Just can't stop. No, I'm
done.
I just can't stop. Don't wanna, ain't gonna. All the days of my life, I'll give you praise. And every knee shall bow.
Shall bow. Every knee shall bow.
Oh,
every tongue confess.
Jesus Christ
is Lord forever.
I just can't stop.
Can't stop.
I don't wanna. All the
stop.
Days of my life.
I just can't stop.
I wanna give you praise.
Jesus.
I just can't stop.
Can't
stop.
No,
I just can't stop. No, I just can't stop. No, no, no. Oh, I just. And every knee shall bow. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord.
This morning we had a great time, amen. It was powerful, spirit of expectation. I was kind of thinking, how do you follow that up? I was in the prayer room. The place was packed. I think we already have. I think we're already expecting God to move. Let's welcome our pastor as he comes tonight.
Praise God. Let's give Jesus praise tonight. Let's welcome the Spirit of God as we have already. Father, we glorify your name. Ain't no better place to be than in the house of the Lord. Can you say amen? Can you shout amen?
Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. I feel that the Holy Spirit is going to operate tonight. I come with the spirit of expectation with you. Amen. If you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter number 16. Amen. Matthew 16, verses 13 through 20. The fabric of society and all that has evolved with society, with human development, as it were, comes from one's perspective. And perspective comes perception. Perspective is how you see something, and perception is how you understand it to be. We look at the fabric of our society now. We have conservative, and we have liberal, Republican, Democrat, and we have many different views, if you will, on life, and it divides homes. You can have a man who grew up on one side of the tracks, while the woman he married grew up on the other side of the tracks. And then you have the home to where they dispute their perspective. Hello, somebody. It creates maybe division. It creates contention. It creates different things. Family homes are built from perspectives. What you were raised on and how you see it is how you understand it to be. Companies are built and even destroyed on this reality. But the thing even greater we have to understand is what we see as a church and how we view God. It is critical, according to A.W. Tozer, he says these words, the rise and the fall of a church is contingent on her view of God. In our text, Matthew chapter 16, 13 through 20, Jesus is addressing that exact issue. Now, can we go to church tonight? The Bible says these words, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? I'm going to stop right there. In the very first part of this, we have to see where they are locally. As we look at the context of our scripture tonight, we are seeing where they are. The Bible says that when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, this is where they were physically. In that area, it was riddled with idolatry. It was riddled with false idols. And Jesus is addressing something that is important to the sustainability, amen, of what he is gonna build, somebody. He says these words, who do men say that I am? The first question Jesus asks is, what is the word on the street? What are y'all hearing out there in the world? How many know that the world has its opinion of God? And it ain't the right one. I said it ain't the right one. He is saying, who do men say that I am? In other words, he is challenging their perspective and their perception. He says, this is the world that you live in. Let me tell you something. Man's inability to see God was since the fall of man. When God created Adam and Eve, there was a knowledge of God through revelation. Are you following me? But the moment man fell into sin was the moment that their understanding of God immediately was masked by what we call our senses. We see, taste, hear, smell, speak. We are ran and operated by this reality. From that moment on, let me tell you something, man understood that God existed. Man has always tried to find or locate God. The problem is that man wanted to see God according to their senses. Our finite minds cannot comprehend a God that is omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. Are you following me? So the very thing that we read in the Bible is Jesus challenging the perspective of fallen man. He is saying, I want you to see the difference, and then I'm going to flip the script on you, and then I'm going to see what you think. We see in today's society, as it began with humanity in their search for God, right after the fall of man, man tried to locate God by idolatry. Are you with me? They would try to build. They would try to create an image that satisfies the sense knowledge they were looking for, because the revelation knowledge is now blocked by sin. Idolatry began immediately after the garden. And so from that time on, Son of God, man has been in pursuit of what they know is God. The problem is this, is that man limits God to their senses. Jesus is saying these words, who do men say that I am? There was a song that came out by Ariana Grande, and she says that God is a woman. We have people like Madonna and Marana, or who have what they say, it's my view of God. This is faulty. This is something that produces many different things. Amen. In the world, it creates relativity. Relativity is saying, you know what? It is all relative. What you think God is and what I think God is are two different things. We'll just agree to disagree. Pluralism is anything but Jesus. There are multiple ways to God, not just Jesus. Are you with me? Here is the folly, is that the world's view of God is always removing the deity and exalting only humanity. As we see this, amen, we can even see it as Jesus. Amen, we just celebrated Easter, the Resurrection Sunday. That through that week, look at the opinion of the people and how quick it changed. Palm Sunday, Jesus coming in, and everybody's waving the palm leaves. They're throwing it down. But then all of a sudden, by Friday, they were crucifying him. As long as Jesus was who they wanted him to be, they were good. But the moment when Jesus was what they needed him to be, it changed. Are you following me tonight? We look at all of these things and we see that as people develop their view on God, it becomes detrimental to how they live their life. Jesus is talking, amen, and he's bringing out a reality. He's setting a precedent of what people say that he is. Martin Luther says these words, "Our view of God is far too human." Mark 6 and 5 is a story when Jesus goes, amen, and he's around the area, and he goes, he's in the local, his local town, and there are people there, amen, some Pharisees and Sadducees, and they begin to say these words, "Isn't that the carpenter's son? Isn't that the one who's from Nazareth? Isn't that the one, wait a minute, that's that fellow who grew up, who makes furniture." But the Bible says that Jesus did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. So what was going on in that scripture is they reduced Jesus to simply human terms and removed the deity of God and a restricted the working hand of God. Are you with me tonight? Their view of God was only that of the boy from Nazareth. He was only the one who can make furniture, not create the world. He was the one, Joseph's son, not God's only son. They reduced Jesus to simply a figure in society. The Bible says these words, as Jesus then turns and appeals to those who are following him. He says the world's gonna have their view. But more importantly, who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? Now we all know Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We can declare it. We can say it tonight. We can believe it. But there's something that happens that Jesus tries to establish here. And he says, I'm going to turn the attention to who you say that I am. Those in his presence, those that are around him. He says, even more importantly, I want to know what the church sees. What the church sees. Amen. Because this is going to revolutionize your walk with God. In Isaiah chapter number 6, we see that Isaiah, we see the Bible says in verse 1, in the year that King Uzziah died, the first words he says is, I saw the Lord. Oh, he says, I saw him high and lifted up. There was a revelation that God allowed a man on this earth while the world was falling apart around him. The heavens opened up and God says, I'll allow your eyes a glimpse and a revelation of what's really going on. Oh, can I tell you here tonight, how you see God is not contingent, amen, on what anybody's view is. It needs to be in line with what God says he is. Amen. This is true and it's tested in time. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. And Jesus is saying there has to be a surety. This has to be revelation. It cannot be secondhand knowledge. It cannot be, amen, just something you hear, but there has to be a revelation of who Jesus is. And I'll tell you why, because it'll change who you are. Isaiah chapter 6, listen to this. In the year that King Uzziah died, verse number 1, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and above it stood seraphim. God is allowing a man, amen, to see into the heavens. Oh, when's the last time you had a glimpse of God's glory? When's the last time in a prayer meeting or in a service or worship service? Saying to God, I'll tell you, it'll change who you are. It'll change your conduct. This is the knee-jerk reaction to somebody who has a revelation of Jesus Christ. I'm here to preach about the Son of God, Jesus Christ, the one true living King of kings and the Lord of lords. And right there, Son of God, Jesus was walking the earth, but the problem was everyone had an opinion. And Jesus says, what does my church say? They all looked at each other. The Bible says these words. Listen to this. Verse 14. Are you ready with me? So they said, some say you're John the Baptist. Some say Elijah. Others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. The detriment here is that every one of these claims removes the deity of God and reduces it to mere men. Hello, somebody. No doubt they thought that he was anointed, no doubt. But the reality, not one of those claims stated the Son of the living God. We see this, that Jesus then in verse 15, but who do you say that I am? Listen to me here tonight, saints. You know what all revival is? Revival is simply a newfound love for Jesus Christ. Simple as that. A newfound love for Jesus Christ. And as Jesus is shifting the focus, he's wanting to know one thing. Have you also been caught up in what everyone else says that I am while you're around me this whole time? The danger is allowing the world's view to seep into the house of the living God. Let me tell you something. This reality has the ability to even split congregations. Well, that's what you think God is. This is what I think God is. Are you with me? It has the ability to cause a contention around those. Jesus is saying, you've got to get this right. In Exodus 33, verses 18, Moses is the man who goes, splits the sea at the command. But in chapter 33, Moses asks one thing. And he says, Lord, thank you for everything you've done. I've seen you bring a mighty deliverance. I've seen miracles. I've seen your power go forth. No doubt your presence is with me, God. Oh, but there's one thing that I request. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Pass before me. God, I've been walking with you. God, I've been listening to you. And God, in his goodness and his mercy, says, I will reveal myself to you, Moses. I will not leave you. I'm going to show you who I really am. Oh, is the last time, saints, that God allowed our eyes to see the glory of God in the midst of a place like this? When's the last time that our eyes were open and a revelation of the goodness and the power of the God we serve was revealed to us? It's not just a theory. It's not just a hope. But I believe that God wants to manifest his presence. You know what manifest presence is? Without controversy. Without confusion. How many know when God does something, there ain't no question that it was God? Come on, somebody. Ask Sodom and Gomorrah. We know that was God, boy. Ain't no question. That wasn't just a fluke. Amen. Well, it was kind of cloudy. It was gonna rain. I kind of called it. You know that was without controversy. Oh, I wish we had a service like that. I said, I wish we had a service like that, where the manifest presence of God healed the sick right in the middle of the sermon, where the presence of God filled people with the Holy Ghost right in the middle of the sermon. Hello, church. Where God has his way in this place and meanders through the aisle, and his presence is revealed to those who sit here and anticipate the power of God. We can see signs and wonders. Thank God for all these things. Oh, but what we need is the manifest presence of God, the revelation of who we're serving. Glory to God in the highest. Come on and give them praise for it. I'm here to declare to you tonight, I don't want to come just for another ordinary service. I'd much rather get out the way and let the Holy Ghost have his way. I'd much rather just shut up and sit down. Amen. The Holy Spirit move, operate, function. I believe too many times that our perspective affects our perception. At conversion, we are in awe and astounded. But through the process of time, we can develop a familiarity. We can develop something to where our perspective changes about God. When we used to believe God for anything. Remember that? Some folks, boy, we'd lay hands on our dogs and get healed. I literally did that. And he got healed. I had a dog back in the day. He got parvo. Good old parvo. Losing his fur, and my wife, she would say, oh, come on, man of God, pray for him. I'm like, are you serious? I know some of y'all are just real holy. He's like, oh, believe God for a dog. Yes, amen. But I was like, for real? Like, for okay, I will. And God healed the dog. I ain't even lying with you. But let me tell you something. Some people put their pets' names on the prayer request. I've prayed for those things before. But the reality is this, is that there is a newfound love and appreciation when there is a revelation. The Bible says without vision, people perish. The other translation is without a revelation, people perish. Glory to God. Isaiah 6, the Bible says Isaiah saw him high and lifted up. And the train of his robe, filled the what? The temple. Can you imagine this? King Uzziah died. There is economical crisis. There is crisis in the kingdom, if you will. And Isaiah, he is fixed by a view of God. By his eyes being open, he is fixed in his calamity. He is fixed in the world that is falling apart around him. Oh, he is fixed because God says, look up here, Isaiah. And the Bible says that he saw him high and lifted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Oh, back in the days of the kings, y'all, it was about the train. The longer the train, the more victories a king would show to have. Because when they would go to war, they would take a swatch of the defeated king's train and they'd attach it onto him. And every time you see a king walk down, they'd look at his train and they'd see how long it is. And they'll know how mighty he is. They'll know how powerful he is. I don't know if you know what I'm saying, but the Bible says that his train filled the temple, that he is ultimately the undisputed, irrefutable champion, the king of all kings and the Lord of all lords. That his train took up every part of the temple, left to right, front to back. That this was a defining moment in Isaiah's eyes. That I saw God. He wasn't whimpering. He wasn't pacing the floor. He wasn't saying, oh my goodness, I don't know what I'm going to do. It's falling apart down there. No, he said he was in complete authority, control, and victory still. But notice this. So can I come down to you? He says, I heard the angels singing. What song were they singing? One word, one harmony to this very day. Holy, holy, holy. He is thrice holy. God the Father is holy. God the Son is holy. God the Holy Spirit is holy. God allowed the eyes of a man in a tumultuous situation. God allowed the eyes to look up to the heavens. And not only that, but he allowed the ears to hear the harmonies and the melodies and the song, the one lyric. Imagine that, being part of one lyric song. And the Bible says that they emphasized his holiness. Stay with me right here. Here is the problem many times with Christianity, American Christianity, is that we love many times to pick an attribute of God that justifies where we are right now. Oh, God is a God of love. He's just love. Of course he is. Absolutely. But the Bible doesn't say that the angels were singing love, 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 love. If they were, they would have been absolutely right, because he is love. The angels weren't singing just. He's a God of justice. If they were, you guessed it, they would have been correct. Righteous, righteous, all of these words, the attributes of God, but they chose holy. Many times when people don't want to change, they will pick an attribute that accommodates or justifies their unwillingness to change. Well, God is a God of love, so I can do what I want. And of course, if you got love, then you got to couple it with mercy and grace, but leave out justice and holiness and righteousness. Hello, somebody. God is holy, and because he is holy, his love is holy. His justice is holy. God is allowing his eyes to see who he is. Amen. In Exodus 33, we see that the glory of God passes before Moses. God says, oh, you bet, I'm going to pass before you. I'm going to show my glory, my character, my essence is going to pass before you. Son of God, I believe that still today, that God is able to display his glory in an auditorium just like this, to people just like us, to reveal his omnipotent power before you and I. And God graced Moses with this request, and the Bible says that he puts him between a cleft of a rock and he passes before him. He allowed Moses to see. Oh, shikarababasai. He allowed Moses to glimpse the glory of God. It wasn't just hearsay. It wasn't just something he read in a book somewhere, but it was the literal presence of God that God allowed this revelation, to transfer past the human capability and see into the spiritual realm, that God manifested himself and satisfied the need of Moses at that time. Jesus meets Saul on the road to Damascus. And old Saul on his horse goes down that old road to Damascus. All of a sudden, a bright light shines, and old Saul gets thrown off his stallion. Boom! And there he is, blinded. And he hears a voice of Jesus saying, "Why do you persecute me?" He had to blind the perspective and the perception of a man in order to give a revelation to a man. Are you with me? Hallelujah. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, the Bible says, "And we all who with unveiled face contemplate the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the image with ever increasing glory." Say it with me, ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Here we see a picture of a bride who with unveiled face, the Bible says that our view of God ought not to be masked by anything, that we have a clear view of the groom. It's a picture of a woman who has a veil over her face that is filtered, obstructed, and cannot have a clear view. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians, he says, with unveiled faces, contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed. Saying to God, listen to me here tonight. That scripture is about covenant and union. That if we cannot see Christ with unveiled face, it plays a part on the covenant or the union with God. Hello, somebody. John 14:9, Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you for so long a time and you do not know me yet, Philip, nor recognize clearly who I am? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" Jesus speaks here, and he goes down the line in our text. Verse 16 of Matthew chapter 16. Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now notice with me, I want you to catch this. Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." There's three things we need to catch in those texts. The very first thing in verse number 16, the Bible says, Simon Peter answered and said. In verse 17, the Bible says, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah." In verse 18, it says, "Peter." Peter is a man who recognized, who has a revelation of who Jesus is in that moment. And immediately, three times, his name changed. From verse to verse, Simon Peter answered, Simon Bar-Jonah, and Peter. When you have this revelation of who Jesus is, hallelujah, it will revolutionize and change your identity. Do you hear me? It will change your... Simon Bar-Jonah is what people knew Peter as. Wavering one. Wavering reed. And Jesus clarifies and he reinstates Peter. And he says, and you are Peter. His name took form. The same way that Isaiah saw as he looked up into the heavens. He immediately saw God in his glory. And he says, I am a man of unclean lips. What am I getting at here? I'll tell you. That when you have this revelation, the Holy Spirit reveals this to you. There's an immediate self-awareness of our own sin. Hello now. We become so aware in the presence of God that we indeed become unclean in the presence of God. Oh, that's revival. You cannot have revival without repentance. And repentance is not just for the sinner, but it is the key to following Christ. Repentance is the key to following Christ. Are you with me tonight? Jesus instates him. He says, you are Peter. Isaiah says, I'm an unclean man with unclean lips. Immediately changes who these people are. Saying to God, it's easy to come to the house of God and not be changed. Hello, somebody. It's easy to sit, but when you have the revelation of who God is, there's an immediate highlighting of the glory of God that brings who we really are. Revivals in the past, one of the things that caused it, that highlighted those revivals were people in the middle of service would begin to repent before even an altar call. Oh God, I'm an unclean man, I'm a sinner. And they'd come down the aisles. Why? Because the glory of God shone in an audience to where it prompted an uneasiness. God, that this is who I am and I need repentance. Jesus says these words. He says, you are Peter, and on this rock, this revelation, he says, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail. Having this revelation, saying to God, listen to me, bring sustainability against hellish assault. Well, I just don't know if I can serve God anymore. I don't know if I want to come to church. You hadn't had a revelation of who Jesus is. Hello now. Jesus also says these words, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. It's all based on what Peter just said. You are the Christ. He says, not only you'll be sustained, but you'll have accessibility into the heavenly kingdom. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. This is something that God is saying, that when you come into contact, oh, when God demonstrates and shows his glory tonight, it'll cause hearts to be changed, reconnected, realigned with who God is. It doesn't matter how long you've been saved. It doesn't matter how long you've been coming to church. It doesn't matter how long. Oh, but the glory of God shines brighter still. Moses came down from that mountain and they thought the sun was setting. Why? Because it changed his countenance. Or you know somebody who's been encountered with Jesus Christ. You know when somebody has a fresh revelation of who God is. Are you with me tonight? It changes who you are. It reconstricts who you are as we come into the house of God. That's what revival is, saints. Amen. And with that, our conduct changes. Convictions are reinstated. Hello now. Convictions are reestablished. Parameters in our own lives are reestablished. Jesus says, with this revelation, you'll be sustained in the biggest assault from hell. You'll have accessibility and power to bind and to loose. Oh, hallelujah. Let's give God praise in the house tonight. Father, we need you. Would you bow your heads in the presence of God? In Jeremiah 20 and 9, the Bible says, "And I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. But his word was in mine heart as a burning fire, shut up in my bones. I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay." Saying to God, it's more than just being inspired. It's more than just being motivated. But when there is an encounter with the Almighty God, there is a fire, an enthusiasm, a zeal that comes with it that is uncontainable. That's how revival spreads. It's an uncontainable fire, a zeal that cannot be withheld, an urgency. Oh, that's how the house of God is built, isn't it? There are some tonight, maybe you're here and you're not right with God, and your entire perspective, how you were raised, where you were raised, circumstances you were in, has skewed your perception of reality. Has skewed. You view life through the lens of violation, abandonment, rejection, fear, anxiety, worry, addiction. And somehow, some way, you think God is the same way. You may not even think God exists. Well, you know what? God is not real. But tonight, Jesus wants to make himself known to you, my friend. He is here this very night to show his power and his presence to those who seek him. And tonight, maybe you're not right with God. You're not saved. You're not born again. You need to get right before God. You need to confess your sin before a holy God. Confess your sin and be saved, changed, delivered. And right now, maybe you're falling under deep conviction and that the Holy Ghost is convicting you of your sin. Well, I just don't feel like I belong here. I feel like I'm out of place. Well, the reason why many times that is because sin that is present and a holy God who is here, not to condemn, but to convict of sin, the Holy Spirit does, to bring to repentance and rejoin a union with God. And maybe you're here, you want to repent of your sin tonight. Would you lift your hand for me? Would you lift your hand right where you are, side to side or front to back? How many in this place? God bless you. Hands going up. How many more? Quickly. God bless you. Thank you. I see that hand. How many more? Right now. You're not right with God. Your entire perspective and perception of God is based on what you hear on the news, on the radios, talk around town. It's caused your life to misstep. It's caused your life. Lies are implemented. You are separated from God. You're not in good standing with God. You need to change your view. You need to change it and align it with what God says he is, the word of God, the canon. And tonight, that's you. How many more? Quickly. You want to repent of your sin. Backslider, how about it? You're running from God. You're backslid. And maybe it changed because sin or carnality was allowed in. And all of a sudden, well, God to me, he ain't like that. He ain't that hard. He ain't like this. He ain't that hard. Well, you know what? And we start messing with who God really is. Oh, when all he is holy and everything else is a subset from this reality. Backslider, return to Jesus. Recommit this very hour right now. Lift your hand for me. Recommit. How many here, I wonder, God's calling you. Oh, Jesus. Let the Holy Spirit move. How many here? Glory to God. Those who lifted your hands for either one of these calls, and maybe you didn't, I want you to stand. You know that you should stand and get right with God. Let's all stand to your feet. If you raise your hand, would you come on down? There are some in the back here. Amen. You want to get right with God? I want you to come on down. Come on down. Meanwhile, I want the church to stand if you're able-bodied. God's speaking to you. We're going to sing a song of worship. We're going to allow the presence of God into this place. Let's fill up these altars. Amen. Let's get a hold of heaven tonight. We need a manifest presence of the Almighty God. God, fresh revelation. Fresh revelation. God, we need you, Lord. Jesus, help us, Lord.
Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Oh, now there's nothing in this world that can ever satisfy. And through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back, I've been set free. And Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need, Christ, my all in all, the joy of my salvation. And this hope never fails. Heaven is our home. And through every storm, my soul will sing, Jesus is here. To God be the glory.
To the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, I want everyone to stand to their feet tonight. God is in the building. I said, God is in the building. Do you believe it? God is here tonight. I want everyone to lift their hands. There are people here, you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. You don't speak in tongues. The evidence is speaking in tongues. And you want to be filled tonight. Lift your hands where you are. Lift your hands where you are. Anybody? Anyone's been saved in the past day or week or month? God's going to fill them right here. Amen. Keep your hands up. How many more? How many more? God's going to fill you. We need the presence of God to operate tonight. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. God's going to fill them with the Holy Ghost. Are you ready? I want you to lift your hands in this direction. God's going to fill them by the Holy Spirit. Others here tonight, maybe you need a refill. Amen. Of the Holy Spirit. God's going to refill you right where you stand. Oh, I wish God would just blow our minds tonight. I believe it. I believe God can do what he wants to do in his house. Amen. Others are coming. Yes. We're going to allow time for them to come. We don't want to rush this. Hallelujah. The presence of the Almighty God is going to come down. Hallelujah. Would you lift your hands with me? We're going to contend for these who need to be filled with the Holy Spirit right now by the power of God. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost right now in Jesus' name. God, that you would fill them with the Spirit of God right now. I want you to lift your hands right now and by faith begin to speak. Let God fill you right now. In the name of Jesus. Touch right now in Jesus' name. There he is, brother. Yes. Fill him with the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name, right now, a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost. Let God touch you, my friend. That's God right now. Yes, yes, speak. Speak it out. He cannot have a best Sunday. Glory to God. Glory, glory. He cannot have a best Seattle Monday. Fill with the Holy Ghost right now in Jesus' name. Let's give God praise in this place. Come on. Do we got a fast song? Jehovah, Alpha and Omega. Oh, I feel the Spirit of God in this place here tonight. Can we go to church? Can we go to church tonight? Can we let the Spirit of God move the way he wants to move? Come on, somebody. Come on, let's sing it. Go ahead, Pastor. Yeah.
Who is like my God? No one. No one. Who is like my God? No one. Jehovah.
Yahweh,
say Yahweh, Yahweh,
in Jehovah, Jehovah, Alpha, Omega. Alpha and Omega, there is no one greater. Yahweh, say away. Just say it one more time. Say away. There is no one greater. You are lifted up, lifted up. Give him praise.
Lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Let the Spirit of the Lord breathe. Oh, God, touch this audience tonight. He cannot have ever best. She cannot have on die. Glory, glory, glory. Send your power, my God. Send your power, my God. He cannot have ever been Sunday. Jesus. Whoa. Hallelujah. Jesus. You can be shut up, my son. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Let God move in this place. Jesus.
For yea, indeed, I am pouring out my fire upon this generation. Yes. And that fire is a fire of jealousy. And I am a jealous God. And I refuse to abdicate my glory and my authority. And I am pouring out my spirit. Mm. And my fire upon a generation, and I will distribute to everyone that asks my fire and my zeal and my glory and my holiness. Only cry out to me, and you cry out as a generation, and I will answer by fire.
Hallelujah. Let's give God some praise in this place. Come on, church. Praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Don't you love Jesus tonight? Aren't you glad you're saved? Come on, I said, aren't you glad you're saved? Fire baptized, Holy Ghost filled, tongue talking, demon casting out in. Hallelujah. Let's shout a praise in this place. Hallelujah. I feel the glory of the Lord. I said, I feel the glory of the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. My brother right here in the black shirt, you want to get filled with the Holy Spirit. God wants me to tell you, it's not that complicated. I'm just waiting for surrender. Let God help you, my friend. Let God breathe upon you. There's sometimes things we try, we resist. Not many times because of pride, but because of fear. And God wants to have access into your heart. There's a destiny, there's a promise, there's a plan, there's a future. And it cannot be accomplished without the power. What good is a commission without power? What good is power without commission? It's a coupled. And God has called you for greater things, my friend. Don't allow fear to stop all that God wants to do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is in the building. Jehovah. Oh, I love that song right there. Can you play that part right there, brother? Alpha and Omega. Oh, we'll say Jehovah, Alpha, Omega. You are lifted. Say it like you mean it. Is Jehovah. There is no one greater. We're going to lift it up. Ready? Say Jehovah, Alpha and Omega.
There is no one greater.
Oh, come on. One more time. Say Jehovah,
Alpha and Omega.
Hey, hey. Hallelujah. Say
Jehovah, Alpha and Omega.
This anointing. The anointing destroys the yoke. The anointing. Don't miss one service. God's having this way. We're living in the latter days. There's a latter rain for us. Let's get it. Let's step into it. All of us, mother, father, aunt, uncle, teenager, student, worker, doctor, preacher, disciple. Don't miss it, man. This is God. We're in the presence of God. He's walking up and down every aisle for you. Tomorrow night, 6 o'clock prayer meeting. Invite someone. Call someone. Anointing is here. Presence of God. Prayer meeting in the morning. Building open at 5. Let's enjoy him. He sings over us. He loves us. God loves you. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Prioritize some things. Put some things to the side. Make him number one. You know why? There is no one like him. Who is like unto God? He has no equals. He has no rivals. He's God alone. Ooh, I feel God up in here tonight. Woo! I want you to go. I want you to go in the power of this. As our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, I'm going to ask Brother Zach to lift his voice and ask God's blessing as we're dismissed. You be a blessing to those around you. And the Lord bless you.